The last thing I remember, I was taking a ride on what appeared to be a regular everyday merry-go-round, but I started to think that merry-go-round wasn't so regular and everyday.
Well, hello there, traveler of the afterlife.
Oh, I don't know how I feel about this gentleman. Hi.
Hello, I am the Ringmaster.
The Ringmaster?
Yes, the Ringmaster.
Well, how do you do, Ringmaster? My name's Goose, and I don't know where the hell I am.
Oh, well, you're here, I think, in the Dark Carnival. It's
not very clear. No, especially when you start with "you're here." I know I'm here, but I wasn't sure where here is.
The Dark Carnival. Yes, Carnival. I guess I should be... I'm rolling my R's.
I mean, I'm going to pick and choose my R's.
My leg itches.
What the hell is this? And why is this? Who are you? I'd have names. I don't know what any of it means.
It's purgatory.
Oh, okay.
Purgatory.
Thank you very much. That was, it's succinct and to the point.
Yes, and I am the judge. Think of me as a Saint Peter.
Okay, so I need to impress you to get out of here.
No. It's already been decided where you go. Okay. I'm the judge. I do a forks up, forks down. I think this means either you go to the hell or to Shangri-La.
So if it's already decided, why... Are you... If I've already judged, why do we need you?
You'll find out in later Joker's cards.
I'm starting to think this
Halls
position...
Halls of Illusion, I think.
All right, these are just keywords.
Yes, but also there's... Maybe you'll eventually see another friend of mine who judges. One sometimes has horns, sometimes doesn't, but always has a crow on his shoulder.
All right, I'm going to go see if Natalie Wood is around.
Natalie Wood? She's long dead. I don't know who that is.
Wait, aren't I dead too?
But let's look back and see what you did wrong in your past.
I want to date Natalie Wood.
Oh, yes. I see you've been very good. You were very prolific in background work and...
All right, that's a cheap shot and you know it.
Stand-up comedy.
Thank you.
You have a Laugh Factory video maybe on YouTube.
It is Helium Comedy Club, but thank you.
Okay, hell yeah, hell yeah.
And it is listed as private, so please don't look for it.
I think I found it once, But I have forks and down and I can clicky-clack anywhere. This is going very long, but what I really would like to see is... Oh, no...
You have to
100 deeds of Eddie Mack or you're going to Hell's Pit. You need to go back to the world because you did the biggest sin ever.
What was that?
You no-butted your friend James too much.
All right, then.
Ooh, but I won't make you go back as a dog.
I'm gonna go date Dorothy from Golden Girls now.
Do you understand what I'm talking about?
Probably
100
not.
Deeds of Eddie Mack, Nickelodeon, Schnick. He didn't get to those hundreds. It got canceled, but you won't be canceled.
Fuck you, dude.
See you later on the Ringmaster.
I'm going away now. Bye. Where's Natalie Wood?
Sean, you need to wake up.
Marsh,
start the show.
What?
Your heart stopped beating. I thought maybe it was a Houdini trick, but let's get going.
Forks up, forks down. Let's go, baby.
Fork sideways. It's a juggalo. A juggalo. Ask what it is. Well, fuck if I know. What is a juggalo? What up, motherfuckers? My name's James, and welcome to Shuffling the Deck, the definitive introductory ICP playlist podcast where we are taking one to two songs from every ICP CD and making the greatest introductory playlist you could even imagine. My name's James. I was a juggalo as a teenager, or I was never a juggalo because once one, always. But if I say I am not anymore, I guess I was just a juffaho. And let's introduce my...
That was so deep and needlessly existential.
It's something that is constantly running around in my head of like, was I a fucking phony in high school?
No, that's
middle
fair.
School.
That's fair. We all live with the sins of our regrets.
Forks
my
up,
name
forks
is Sean. I'm also the host of this. I used to watch them on Mad TV and WCW. Never listened to the music. So this is also an introductory podcast for me.
Hell to the world
of the Dark Carnival.
Forks up, forks down, yeah, forks sideways.
Nice.
Crime pays.
Good shit. Should we, do we just hop into the year? I think that's what we did, right?
I mean, Yeah, because we don't need to talk about... can I quickly say something real quick?
Oh, please do.
I was watching this black metal documentary last night, and I shut it off like 30 minutes in because I'm like, these dudes, it's early black metal. I'm like, these dudes were all just pricks.
Yeah.
They were like neo-Nazi pricks.
Ugh, gross.
And I'm like, why? You guys are okay with this?
Fuck bigots, man.
That, oh yeah, hey.
Hey.
Still, they're carrying over themes from previous CDs.
We'll get into it. I forgot. There was one thing I wanted to talk about before we get super deep into it. Can I tell you my favorite part about last week's episode?
Yes.
Is the part where I did not listen to two of the songs on the album, and we did not talk about it. All right, moving on.
Wait, well, oh, okay.
1993, and we did not talk about it.
Ooh, 1990s rock and roll.
If you want to know what songs I did not listen to, listen to the first episode. It's actually pretty apparent.
Oh, because you just didn't talk about
them. We did not spend
them.
Much time on
okay.
it.
Okay.
Okay, but 1993.
No. Correct?
No, what year did this come out?
94.
Oh, my research is fucked then.
Okay, well, you want to know what? Okay, next week we're doing Terror Wheel and Beverly Kills 902187 or whatever the fuck it's called.
Okay.
90187.
What years are those?
That is 92 and 93. So okay. You could do 94.
Okay.
In next episode.
Which we probably will. And yeah, because I got 93 stuff here.
Why? Why would you do that?
Because I done fucked up.
I'm going to spank those knees that I can clearly see through ripped jeans.
This is... Oh, I'm ignoring you. This is the Rust Belt Retrospective segment.
Ooh.
Not a lot in Michigan. Just the top five stories as voted on by the AP. Number one. A lot
AP
of
it, bio?
That's the one starring Patton Oswalt and Dennis from It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
Ooh, yeah. This is two for two today. You're trying to remember actors' names from that show.
And I am failing all over the place.
You know Charlie Day, though.
Is that the one that plays Danny DeVito?
Oh!
Got him. A lot of the news stories are kind of continuations from 92. So the number one was Governor Engler ended the use of property taxes to fund schools. Which sounds really bad.
I'll get into my notes on him right now.
Do it. You have notes on Engler?
Yes, because there is a line that I was like, holy shit, this is Rust Belt shit that you were talking about.
Okay.
So my parents at the time were hardcore Republicans.
Fun.
I don't know if they are now, especially like since Trump kind of like...
Since the party became a cult?
Yes.
Yeah.
So... And by hardcore Republicans, I just mean like they always voted Republican.
Sure.
There is a picture, because I'm the youngest, there's a picture of my mom, my brother, sister, and then me at an Engler
rally,
like campaign stop, I believe.
Yeah.
But it is only my head on the bottom, like you can just see my spiky hair, how 90s kids did.
Hell yeah.
There's probably a bald spot there.
How old were you?
I pulled out my hair and I found out why. I realized that might have been too young. I might not have been back then.
All right.
That's getting bleeped out, baby.
I like it.
But true fans know what I'm talking about.
True heads know what's up.
But yeah.
Yeah.
So I do have some notes on this motherfucker wherever it's on.
Because I don't have a lot of notes on Michigan, so this will eat up segment time in my segment.
He was governor of Michigan from 91 to 2002.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
But if you look at Engler critics, like hoping to like get like what people were against him during his governor, you don't get anything because in 2019 when the what the fuck was his name, like Nestor, that just absolute monster who was a sports physician at MSU and raped many people. So during that, Engler was the interim president because the other, the current president was like, they needed to focus all their time on dealing with that.
Yeah, that sounds like a douche.
And everyone just was like, wow, like MSU was doing pretty good, but wow, this dude just fuck jobbed everything and specifically was like made comments of saying, well, the victims are getting more than their 15 minutes in the spotlight.
Wait, and who said that?
Engler.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so he's a fuck boy.
Yeah.
And the only other thing I could see, like, critiques about him was, which falls into a specific lyric, which we'll get into later.
Yeah, yeah.
He was very much for welfare reform.
Okay.
So.
So, cool. He also cut funding for public schools. After a proposal, like, it seemed like it was a messy situation, but I feel like property taxes probably should go to schools.
Yeah.
I'm not an economist or an education specialist, but it seems like it's important to put money into schools, especially with like where we fall in a couple years as far as education, like worldwide education goes.
Especially when, I mean, it should also go there, but other factors should, because then you fall into the poor areas get the least amount of funding for schools and all of that. We are, if any other ICP podcast starts to talk like that, it's zero. None of them have. That makes sense. But what you need to remember is the poor areas also will have poor funding. We need to make sure we have more reform on public schools, not just strip all funding away from them.
Truly. No, which is the more important thing is that we reform, not just throw money at to a problem, which I would never suggest. I would never suggest that, dear listeners, but that we get traditional reform. So that's what. So in 93, that's what Engler's about, fucking just taking out the money. The second top story, as I roll on, Kevorkian's back in the news.
Was Kevorkian in Michigan?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Kevorkian's a Michigan boy.
What was he like? What, Southgate?
I don't know anything in Michigan is. So in 92, he was acquitted. In 93, he is fighting assisted suicide bans because the assisted suicide have been banned. He was acquitted, but assisted suicides have been banned. So he got jailed and held two major hunger strikes. Eventually, two courts do rule that the ban on assisted suicides is unconstitutional. Jack Kevorkian doing that work.
What? This is a serious question, or you can turn it into a joke. How do you feel about assisted suicides?
I'm not funny enough today to turn that into a joke. I mean, it's one of those things. If it hurts to live, if your quality of life is like, I don't know. I feel like you should have the right to like agree to like, hey, my quality of life is less than life. It's not great right now.
Mm-hmm.
You should have. I don't know. I feel like you're supposed to have that right.
Yeah.
I think that's supposed to be the thing. Oh, are people still having debates on assisted suicide?
I have no idea now, but it feels like.
But it was a big thing when we were growing up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because
that was
of this.
Yeah. Jackie Kevorkian's baby.
That's. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I wish someone would assisted suicide me.
Did you think that was going to be a joke?
No, it's okay, a for real thing.
Oh, God, that's the saddest thing ever.
I assisted suicide in my best friend last year.
Jesus, did you really?
Yeah, he's right there.
Wait.
In that urn.
Oh, I thought you were pointing to the marshland mask.
Oh, no, I thought you were going to be like you're pointing at Yogi Bear.
You're pointing
at Yogi Bear. I straight up stuck a needle into that bear, and he said, "Oh, see the picnic baskets in the sky." And I was like, "Your forever hunger is over, sir." He'll never be satisfied.
God damn it. I'm moving on to the third story.
We made it a joke.
The third top story.
That started with me wanting to kill myself and talking about my friend Franklin in an urn right now.
It ended with Yogi Bear. I'm proud of you. Shouts out to Franklin.
That's just, if you keep going, eventually you'll find the fun.
I need to finish my segment.
That's how you spitball writers' rooms, baby.
James, I need to finish this segment. It's already our least popular segment, and I just need to get
through. You don't know that. Zero episodes.
I know.
Have been released.
All right. I'm just self-deprecational.
I think our intros will be the least
popular segment, probably. what's your least favorite segment on the show? Let us know in the comments below.
After one episode and maybe a fourth of one.
Possibly. The third top story in Michigan, as voted on by the AP, is the baby Jessica case. This was a legal case, a custody case, between the adoptive parents and the biological parents. The baby was put up for adoption before the father knew. The biological father knew that the biological mother was pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, the biological parents end up together, they're married, and they sue for custody of the baby.
Wow.
They win the custody.
Wow.
It becomes a big media circus.
Yeah.
I don't have an opinion on it one way or the other. I did very pretty shallow research on it. I know the interesting thing, though, was the media spin. There was a lot of, like, pro-adoptive, like, hey, we should take care of the adoptive parents. We probably should. We should probably protect their rights as well. I don't know the deep lore of the case, though, but it was it's just very interesting, and that's coming, just this huge custody. It's like Maury, but like big time legal case.
I will not say specifically who, but within my family, a family friend was going to adopt the baby of a family member of mine who got pregnant as like in their late teens. And then after having the baby, this family member was like, oh, wait, no, I'm like, realized they wanted to keep the child.
Yeah.
And it just ruined, they're a family friend no longer.
Yeah.
Which makes,
It's messy. Like, that's the thing. It's something I'm not going to like put my two cents in because it's a messy, tricky situation. That it also like changes from context to context.
I think once it's like the adopting, like the papers have been signed at this point with my family, it had not been because I think they were going to even forego a lot of the like expensive stuff that might go along with that, but then opened it up to be like, well, no,
you didn't sign the paperwork.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a tricky, mad world.
I was going to say, I feel like there was an American Dad episode, but I think it was whatever baby got trapped in the well, or it might have been also baby Jessica. I'm not sure which baby.
I will not allow you to detract this segment with American Dad. Story number four is the continuation of Malice Green, who we talked about last week.
Yes.
The Malice Green story in 93, this is the murder case where the officers are arrested and convicted for the murder of Malice Green. And the fifth story is Coleman Young retires from mayor of Detroit, replaced by Dennis Archer. He's elected to be the next mayor. And that's, I don't know, new mayor, the first African-American mayor of Detroit to be retires after, like, I think something like 10 years. And then is the next elected official is the first African-American president of the Bar Association.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah. So that's what's going on. That's what's going on in Michigan in 1993.
Have you seen Detroiters?
No, we talked about this last week, I think, too.
The Beast Masturbator from the Chris Gethard show.
I still have to get through the wrestling stuff.
He plays a juggalo. He's Tim Robinson's brother, and he's just like a degenerate juggalo.
Sure.
It's fantastic.
Watch Detroiters. But before I get into the wrestling retrospective, Marsh, what's happening? What's happening in the world of music? Tell me why not.
God, let's go into my top five. This was
this is the Billboard top five, right?
Yes, there are.
So it's not your top five. It is Billboard top five.
I'm not looking through. What are my favorite? My top favorite songs from '94 would probably be like from this album.
Hell yeah.
Okay, so and maybe from I think Closed Caskets came out at this time. That's a Isham album.
Okay,
it's his best.
Heard.
So this is the top five for the January 28th. It seems like this came out on a weird date.
January 28th?
Yeah, I think it's a Thursday or a Friday, and it's supposed to come out on Tuesdays back then. But since this was an indie release, that might be why.
Okay.
Or maybe they had like a record release, and that is the release date. There are conflicting dates.
Okay.
So I'm going for the week of this.
Okay.
The top five goes number five, Janet Jackson's Again.
Mm-hmm.
Number four is Power of Love by Celine Dion.
Okay.
Number three, coming in, Toni Braxton's Breathe Again. I was going to say Breath Again.
Okay.
Number two, Mariah Carey's Hero. And coming in at number one, what do you think it is?
I kind of want them to continue it. I want to guess a Madonna.
No. Madonna was last week.
Yeah, I know. I thought she'd come back. Okay, so it's not. Well, that was my guess.
All right, it is number one, Bryan Adams with All for Love. So zero hip hop in here.
No, and four out of five, I believe the French term is chercher la femme, women singers.
Okay.
Like four out of five major women pop, like women pop to R&B singers. That's interesting.
I was
James, are you ready to talk about the wrestling retrospective in 1993? Because I didn't know this album came out in 1994.
I thought this was the wrestling review.
The wrestling review, maybe. I don't fucking know. This is Goose Talks About Sweaty Boys. That's the name of the segment.
Goose talks, don't sweat though.
Yeah, that's why I have to talk about the sweaty boys. Because I don't get to sweat. I have to sweat vicariously.
Gotta wring that neck out of the sweat.
These 1993 boys, which again, apply this to next episode, apparently. In the WWF. Raw premieres on January 11th, 1993.
Holy shit.
First episode of Raw, headlined...
Ooh, baby, I like it.
...by a segment featuring Doink... Not headlined by a match. The last thing to air... the last thing on air is Doink the Clown with Vincent Kennedy McMahon and Crush. This is heel Doink, by the way, played by Matt Bourne. So he's a bad guy. Vincent Kennedy...
Like these clowns.
VKM is like, hey, stop scaring children. And Doink's like, fuck you. And then Surfer Crush comes out and is like, I don't like that you're scaring children, bro. And then Doink's like, hey, fuck you. And Doink continues to scare children. Like, he makes children cry. That's the specific wording. Because he's a big evil clown. The first episode of Raw, we also have the Lex Express. If you're familiar with Lex Luger, which I'm from Buffalo. I'm going to shout out Lex Luger every chance I get.
Is he from Buffalo?
Yeah, born and raised. Never billed from Buffalo. It's always like from Boca Raton, Florida. Or they bill him from Chicago sometimes. They never bill him from Buffalo.
Did he train?
He's born and raised in Buffalo.
In other cities?
Maybe. I don't know.
That could be where.
It could be. It could also just be no one wants to talk about Buffalo.
Is it because Boca Raton has a rich wrestling schools?
Not that I know of.
Okay.
I think part of it is also he was just a huge bodybuilder, right? And like they wanted to, because he was a body guy, so they just wanted to build him from all these places where you would want to see Lex Luger on a beach.
Yeah, but then it's he's like built like a buffalo.
Yeah, I know. They just never build him from Buffalo. Like, it could also just be a rib on him. Everyone just being like, "Hey, fuck you and fuck Buffalo," because I think yeah, this is the year we lose our fourth Super Bowl in a row.
Ooh,
yeah, maybe. But the Lex Express, if
you're
unfamiliar, never
gonna get it. Never gonna get it because you suck as hell.
Lex debuted in the WWF as a heel. He was a bad guy, and around '93 is when they're like, you know what? Hogan is about to leave. Like, Hogan's getting older. Lex is gonna be our new big star. Lex is gonna be our next Hogan. So they put him on a bus. This is how they decide to make him. They didn't put him in matches because he can't wrestle that well. I love Lex. He can't wrestle that well. And he can't talk that well. So what they do is they put him on like a tour bus, deck it out in America colors, and he just goes from town to town being really awkward in public events. Meanwhile, Bret the Hitman Hart is just fucking crushing it. He's having some of the best matches of his career.
Lex Luger.
Him and Lex Luger. I mean, that's essentially that.
Oh, no, I have no idea.
No, they have a match.
Oh.
Yeah, they wrestle, but like it's always... But he's like wrestling Shawn Michaels right now. He's wrestling Davey Boy Smith, a.k.a. the British Bulldog. Vader is in WCW right now.
Nah, he's at the beach at Boca Raton with your boy.
he'll be there soon, don't you worry. But like, yeah, but Bret's having these great matches. The fans are like all on him, Bret. The modern, the modern equivalent would be sort of the Daniel Bryan. When the Daniel Bryan started getting really popular with the fans, to the point where those yes chants, like WWE did not want to push Daniel Bryan, but everyone in the everyone watching in the arena was like, "Fucking push Daniel Bryan!" Uh-huh.
So I cry during some of those highlights.
That's essentially what's going on with Bret and Lex right now in the WWF. Also, my last note for WWF is WrestleMania 9, which is a very interesting WrestleMania. This is the one that takes place in Caesar's Palace. So everything's kind of this Roman feel in Las Vegas. The Caesar's Palace Casino and blah, blah, blah.
You're saying that you pointed at me like, oh, James doesn't know this, but no, it's like, I've been to Vegas before.
I just use my hands. Congratulations. You want
shout out to Power Playthrough. They're a podcast from Las Vegas.
Shouts out Power Playthrough.
WrestleMania
9 is the first time we see Jim Ross in WWF.
The audacity.
The big weird thing about WrestleMania 9 is what I want to get to. It's also Hulk Hogan. Because this is Hogan's last year in the WWF.
No.
Okay.
I don't want it to be.
But it's okay. He'll be back. What he does on his way out, and it's this big gross net. So, in King of the Ring, Bret the Hitman Hart, and again, everyone's in love with Bret the Hitman Hart.
They want to fuck.
Who doesn't want to fuck?
They want to jack him off with his hair grease.
Absolutely. Get that greasy handy. He wins the title from Ric Flair at the King of the Ring. Ric Flair is about to go back to WCW.
A lot of like,
yeah,
men growing up were like, oh man, that'd be so fucking hot. He like takes his grease out of his hair and just jacks me off.
I have so many notes to get through.
Why do you have so many?
Because I didn't think you were going to interrupt me with hand jobs.
Well, it's kind of a comedy show,
maybe
bitch.
That's on me. Anywho.
So anal who?
Hulkamania, and Hulkamania at this point is dead. Like, people are booing Hulk Hogan.
Hell yeah.
Because they're tired of the 80s shtick. It's just the same stuff.
NWO.
So what Hogan wants to do at WrestleMania, Bret is facing Yokozuna for Bret's World Heavyweight title. He won it from Ric Flair, and again, Bret's hot. What happens is Yokozuna beats Bret at the main event of WrestleMania 9. Hogan comes out and is like, you cheated, because of course he cheated. Yokozuna was the bad guy. And Bret's like, oh no, Hogan, help me. Hogan beats Yokozuna in like an impromptu after the bell
ding, ding.
Squash match. And then Hogan takes the title. And instead of like what they were kind of building to was then at SummerSlam, Bret and Hogan face Bret. And there's a sort of passing of the torch as mm-hmm. Hogan drops the belt to Bret. Hogan doesn't want to wrestle Bret because Bret is at his peak. He's going to out-wrestle him. So Hogan instead drops the title back to Yokozuna and then just takes off. So fucking Hulk Hogan takes off to, ladies and gentlemen, WCW. With Bill Watts resigning, being replaced with Eric Bischoff and Ole Anderson. Eric Bischoff is gonna be a big name in WCW. If you're an NWO guy, you probably know who Eric Bischoff is. He takes over in 93. Jim Ross resigns, jumped to WWF. We talked about that. And the WCW in 1993 officially leaves the NWA. So they're no longer a part of the National Wrestling Alliance. They are becoming their own thing with Eric Bischoff at the helm. This is where we start seeing WCW becoming the WCW we would recognize.
Nitro.
Later on. Yep.
TNT.
Yep. That's the one.
The Superstation.
And that's what's coming on with the big two. I do want to talk about FMW, which is a Japanese promotion.
Full motion video.
Ayo, ayo. Video, because it's W. Uh-huh. Full motion video.
No, it's just two V's of video.
And if you're like, I have never checked out FMW, but I'm into like, say, John Moxley right now. A lot of John Moxley's gimmick and what he's doing as he walks to the ring, he's pulling from Onita and what Onita was doing in his death matches as FMW, especially with like the JCW and like that death match hardcore style. A lot of that's coming from FMW at the time. Recommend that. And in 1993...
Hey, real quick, do you think I'd be a good gaijin?
I don't know. I think you'd be a good bad gaijin. I would like to see you come out and just I could see you kind of coming out as like a Don Callis kind of bad guy manager, where it's like, yeah, he's American. What's wrong with you? Bah. Like, I could see you riling the people up real good.
I don't think I'll edit out what I'm saying right now, but I asked the same thing last week,
what
and
I
you
say
said,
then?
Fuck no, and then kept moving on.
I took too many notes, and we took too long on Michigan.
Yeah, we did an adequate time on Michigan.
We did too long, okay.
Because one of my notes is now crossed out. We don't need to go to that one now.
I promise this is my last thing, because I do want to, I feel like ECW. Is very important to what JCW becomes.
JCW.
And ECW forms. So we're going over that real quick. They originally form as the Tri-State Wrestling Alliance by owner Joel Goodhart. That's like in 1989.
Get Joel out. Get Joel out.
By 92, he is out. He is gone. He sells the company to Todd Gordon, who renames it to Eastern Championship Wrestling. In 93, Booker, wrestler, and former GWF title holder. He was just a guy bouncing around the indies, bouncing around a lot of outlaw and NWA promotions. Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert. He's their booker. He gets them TV time on Sports Channel Philadelphia.
Philly?
I'm sorry, he does that in 92. By 90, so they're on TV. ECW's on TV. And in 93, Todd Gordon replaces Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert with new booker, the recently released Paul Heyman.
Oh, man, I cried when he was released.
Paul Heyman has left WCW, Paulie Dangerously on WCW. He's now Paul Heyman, head booker of ECW in 93. Things are coming up. There's still Eastern Championship Wrestling, but things are coming up. Paul Heyman's in charge. That is the Sweaty Boys with Goose segment.
Paul Heyman at his peak could Navi me hard.
Oh, stuck your braid in the back of my neck until I come buckets, Paulie.
Well, guys, today we're talking about Ringmaster.
Yes,
and
we are.
Before we get in track by track, Goose.
Yeah, yeah.
With thoughts.
Definitely more. You see a lot of their themes coming through a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
Where I feel like especially listening to the two compared, Karnak was a little more scattered. I'm saying this to piss off all the juggalos out there.
No, I think they will the people who understand why we keep saying Karnak will appreciate that we know the Karnak story.
I'm trying to get cool heel heat, where I'm clearly a bad guy, but like I still get signs in the audience. I'm getting that Kevin Nash heat, baby.
Oh, man, there was a fucking hilarious sign. Oh, I wish I remembered what it was. I was going to send it to you, but you were streaming, so I was like, he won't see it until later.
Well, like, I still wanted to see it. Well, if you see it again, send me that sign. And if you're listening, send me fun wrestling signs, because I love that shit. But, like, definitely let's, like, Karnak feels scattered compared to this album, where mm-hmm. it's very much they're hitting on death, they're hitting on the afterlife. Oh, my gosh, the dead one. Which we'll get into, but ooh. There's so many themes in that album from that song, and that makes so much sense to me, especially like the afterlife and purgatory. Yeah, a much more focused album, it feels like, as far as like themes go.
Chew.
But I think also, because this comes up too a lot. Hey, Marsh.
Yes.
What do the Insane Clown Posse think a chicken head is? Because I thought I knew what a chicken head is. And I don't think I know what a chicken head is.
Well, are you thinking of chicken head as in Project Pat's chicken head?
What's a project? Wait, who's Project Pat?
Oh, chicken head. That's a lady
who has oral sex with a penis. Yes,
yeah.
That's what I thought it was. Then they use chicken head in some ways that don't seem to apply to oral sex.
Well, I think this came out before the Project Pat song.
Okay. Yeah, because the way they're talking about chicken, they're like, chicken heads or chicken necks. We're going to use it to murder you fucking bigot. I'm like, okay, cool. I thought that was oral. Like,
well, no, I think they're calling them chicken heads and chicken necks.
Yes, which is just like so, like, and in 2021 and like what, you know, what that phrase became in hip hop, because it's a
chicken.
It's
chicken head.
Very weird to hear it used in a different context.
So my brother with the aforementioned last week, Terry Ripley, Terry loved 3-6 Mafia and Hypnotized Mind, like especially Frasier Boy. Oh my god.
I love Frasier.
Oh wait,
toss
really?
Salad and scramble eggs.
Frasier Boy. Okay. Different spelling because it has B-O-Y at the end.
Okay, but I am picturing like a 19-year-old. It's a 19-year-old's body with Frasier Crane's head, but like old Frasier Crane's head just on a 19-year-old body and just chains and like a cardigan.
Okay, I'm fine with that.
Okay,
so
Frasier Boy.
My brother was, he looked like a cross between that guy from Green Day and that guy who writes comic books and was in My Chemical Romance.
Billy Joel and Gerard Way?
Yeah, looked like a cross between them. He would like two-step like how emo kids would to chicken head.
Heard.
And Terry loved that.
Aww.
So
you totally lost your train of thought.
I think that's all I wanted to say.
Okay, because we were talking about like general thoughts
yes.
on the album before we get into it. Yeah.
So this, depending on the time of year, and depending on it, maybe if I'm trying to be like cool, I don't know which side I hang on, like being cool that is.
Yeah.
This is my favorite Joker's card.
Okay.
But sometimes it'll go to like Amazing Jekyll Brothers, or I think the best Joker's card is Shangri-La. Okay. But Amazing Jekyll Brothers and this, they battle it out as my favorite.
Well, and there's always a difference between my favorite and the best.
Yes.
Like my favorite video, one of my favorite video games is Fallout New Vegas. It is by no means the best video game of that year even, but I just love it. It just makes me very happy to play.
The best sex act, I think, is just Missionary. My favorite is being peed on.
Yeah.
That's which some would say honest that's
not
to
even,
God.
That's not even sex. That's just a great way to battle jellyfish.
Which, also, a very quick tangent.
Fuck jellyfish.
OnlyFans release that they will be doing without like sex.
Yeah, that's bullshit.
Yes, it is bullshit. But people are like, oh, the people are gonna finally will have more people work. you know, and it's like, no, Japan has such strict pornography stipulations, but it's still a $1 billion industry in Japan.
Yeah.
Like you have to, you'd think like, oh, well, if you censor out the genitals, no one will like this. But it's, you have to get hyper niche and specific for it to be like, oh, this like tentacle porn would not exist if that shit wasn't there. Just like a lot of comedy.
Yeah. Boundaries breed creativity.
Yes, exactly. So, like, if someone's just peeing mm-hmm. into a toilet, like, that will still get a bunch of people on your OnlyFans, but it is not sexually explicit. It is just, if you're breastfeeding and you're taking the hormones to develop milk, I'm guessing you can do that.
Yeah.
I once saw a video. It was a pornography.
Oh, I've heard of those.
And it was just a woman. This was like on LimeWire days. Mm-hmm. A woman poured a bowl of, what's it called, cornflakes, whipped her breast out, and then squirted milk in it, then started eating it. Like, okay. That isn't sexually explicit. Now, what is sexually explicit is there's this one woman who I found by just searching. I was like, there's got to be Orbeez in Pornhub. And it's like, okay, yeah, there's one person sure. just putting 100 Orbeez in her anus, then pushing them out.
Jeez.
But she had like a milk enema and then it's just like poured some cornflakes. I think it's an homage to that LimeWire shit. So I think
I know where it came from. I want to give it up to the OG cornflake titty milk woman.
Yeah. So I think the whole this also goes for like any like punk rock type shit like ICP mm-hmm. and even just rap music in general. You don't have the capabilities of being a full band because you don't have the resources. All you have is like an MPC and a microphone, and that's it. Mm-hmm. So that's all you need to make great music. And I think OnlyFans will be the same thing. Of course, people will move platforms unless if you have such, it's also the same thing as YouTube. If you have such a huge following on YouTube and then YouTube does all this bullshit to hamper your income, you have to find a way to work within those stipulations because you already, like, people won't end up following you over to those other things.
I mean, at the end of the day, my hard stance is OnlyFans, fuck off. Stop trying to stigmatize sex workers.
Yes.
But, like, sex work, I mean, you have to believe that these people who have made their life are going to continue living. Like OnlyFans, you're gonna make things weird. Congratulations, the forbidden doors have opened. You did this to yourself.
Here's what OnlyFans should be doing. They should be saying, "Hey, banks," because that's the main issue is banks not wanting to work with porn sites.
Sure.
And cowards. Investors not wanting to invest because of that.
Cowards.
What they should do is say, "Hey, banks and investors, fuck you," and what that will end up breeding is a new person to make a PayPal type site that is like, fuck it, we will work with pornography, we will work with people who sell weed, all of this stuff, that as long as it's legal.
Because the more we push these groups into the fringes, the fucking more dangerous it gets to be people who are just trying to fucking live.
Yes, and also heavy themes of this album.
Yes, absolutely.
So let's get into it. We can segue into
shit. I love this.
Okay, the first thing, every single album, I will have a story from my teenage years.
Okay.
Revolving around this album.
Sure.
And the one that sticks out the most, I went bowling with my friend Dakota Rust and one of his girlfriends. I don't remember.
Dakota Rust, getting it out.
Yeah. So bowling was a huge thing in Muskegon because I can never remember the name. Whatever the biggest bowling company there is that I always forget the name of.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
Their headquarters is in Muskegon.
Oh, shit. So Brunswick. Yeah, Muskegon's kind of the bowling capital of the country. Yeah.
It's a bowling capital.
Yeah.
So too many bowling alleys in this fucking town. Guess what? Now there is just the proper amount of bowling alleys in this town. So
an acceptable amount of bowling alleys in Muskegon today.
Which is sad because now people don't bowl.
People are out of work.
Muskegon's on the rise, they say. They say, Muskegon, watch us go, and it's watch Muskegon, and it's the U.S. and the G.O. and Muskegon highlighted, so it's watch Muskegon, watch us go. It's bullshit. I always make fun of it.
Okay.
I hate Muskegon.
Okay.
So he invited me because it was him, Brittany Merritt, and Nicole's sister, Ashley Jacus. If Ashley's like, don't say, you'll know, same last name as Nicole. So
have I met Nicole? Do I know Nicole?
Yes.
Okay.
You've been around. Shut up. When you met me, you met Nicole.
Yeah, I know. I'm having fun.
So I went there and I had to message Dakota because I was like, I need to know what these circumstances were. Mm-hmm. Was I there as a, like, hey, you talk to the one that I'm not dating?
Yeah, like wingman.
Yes.
Interference.
Or was I already dating an ex of mine, Megan, at the time? So, like, what? Because, and I asked, I was like, was I either just not interested because I was already dating someone, or was I just, I did not know social cues and how to act in public, because the entire bowling trip, I had headphones on listening to Ringmaster.
Okay, what?
So I asked him, I sent him a very long message.
Yeah, oh my God.
And very specific.
That's.
And I was like, hey man, you probably won't know this because it's so specific. And then this is what he sent back. He said, it took me a minute, but you were with Megan at the time and I was dating Ashley. So you definitely came with because we did everything together. And instead of socializing, you had headphones on the entire time.
So you just, so he invited you to be like, we're friends. Please come, please hang out with me.
Yeah.
But because there were, because there were single women about, you pulled a Mike Pence and said, no, I can't talk to women while I'm dating.
I
can't have a meal with another woman while I'm dating.
I don't think.
Ringmaster.
Maybe he, one of us is thinking wrong, because I feel like I wasn't dating Megan at this time.
Okay.
Because, like, I would
have. You were just really into Ringmaster.
Yes. And wasn't into, like, other people's bullshit.
Sure.
I was into ICP. Music just let me be my own cloud in the sky.
Hell yeah.
And it was, I mean, it definitely affected me socially, but who cares, baby? It was either, okay, so here's this. It was either I go hang out at a bowling alley listening to ICP on repeat, or I stay home and play and beat Spyro Ripto's Rage for the fourth time that week while listening to ICP on repeat.
When you have, if maybe you're not the most atypical social person.
Oh, I should have been high.
I'll say this for it. It's so important to be like, to have a group of friends that can, like, hey, we understand you're atypical socially.
Mm-hmm.
You can come out with us and just listen to Ringmaster.
Yeah.
But just your presence with us is enough. So that's how that Dakota sounds dece.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Dakota was my only Juggalo friend.
Hell yeah.
There are pictures. I never know if he's fine with me posting them, so I don't post them.
Mm-hmm. Well, because he's cutting Mr. Johnson's head off in the pictures.
Oh, yeah.
Naturally.
We'll talk about it more when we get to Shaggy Two Dope's first release, first solo, like, LP.
Yeah.
We went to a sign-in, and we were Juggalo painted up, and I'll post those when we get to that. But let's start getting
my second point, real quick, was just also how important escapism. One of the reasons I was not a Juggalo and really unaffiliated until, like, I started, you know, I have not listened to the music until this podcast. But one of the reasons I wanted to was because I understand, for me, escapism was, I guess this would be a little bit later, but especially Mitch Hedberg albums, when I started listening to Mitch Hedberg a lot more.
Who?
Mitch Hedberg, the stand-up comedian.
I thought you were saying
Helberg. I kind of like mumbled it.
I thought you said Mateber.
Mateberg. Yes, Mateberg, the comedian. But it would be so important to me, like, while I was walking to school, if I was waiting for the bus, to, like, pop on Strategic Grilling Locations and Mitch All Together and, like, be out. But, like, I wasn't. When you want to be out because you do desire human contact, but, like, it's uncomfortable for you still. Like, that's a real thing, to be like, I know I want to be out. I want to be out with people. I just don't feel comfortable with it. And having your headphones in and, like, something that's comforting like that, like Ringmaster or Strategic Grilling Locations, whatever that is, that's huge. And, like, and again, yeah, ICP, and that's a huge theme, is if you feel uncomfortable and outside, they're very blunt with it, but that it's okay.
Yep.
And that is, like, that's beautiful. That's good. That's beautiful.
It's absolutely why I gravitated towards them. And once I started listening to them, I credit ICP for making me more sociable. Yeah. And being able to, or being more confident with me being a weirdo.
Yeah. Like that's it. Because just because you're socially atypical, first of all, I need to look how this is. But I think the song is You're Invited. I just came up on a random playlist. I'll shoot you it later. You can put it in the notes or something. But I just remember, the entire song is like, hey, I know, Miss, you don't have to stay at home and not go to the party because you don't feel invited. Like, the chorus is, you're invited to everything if you want to go. You don't have to go, but if you want to go, if you really want to go somewhere, you are invited.
Mm-hmm.
And it's finding those tricks for socially atypical people that will get us out. That was a huge, that'd be a huge thing. If I would go to a party, I'd go somewhere, even up through college, which was like my coming out as far as socially goes. But it would be like, my big fear was, oh, they don't want me here. I know those are my friends talking in the corner. They're having such a good time without me. I can see their conversation. They're having a very fun conversation without me. I would intrude. And it takes a lot to kind of like break that down and finding certain healthy escapist things like this album. You are invited is such an important lesson to learn. And I think, and it's something this album does very well, something ICP does very well.
Yeah.
Let's get into it.
All right, guys. Today, we listen to Ringmaster, and it's, guys, here's some of the liner notes. It says, who's guilty? The day has come. The time of reckoning. Who will perish in dreaded hell, and whose soul will be content within the pleasures of heaven? So they weren't even on the Shangri-La Hell's Pit tip right now, so that's something to be aware of. Looking past the words spoken with a wicked tongue, and looking past the evil deeds done within one's life, but instead looking into the conscience of man. That's a part of the liner notes from Ringmaster.
Yeah.
So let's get in. First up, we had Wax Museum, which, like a lot of these in the early ICP, it's great, it's awesome, and then goes on a minute and a half too long.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it's just loops.
It's a little... We're not going to talk about the intro? Because I think the intro is interesting.
No, Wax Museum is the intro.
Oh, am I thinking of something? Am I wrong? Hold on.
It's like, oh, hello, welcome to the Wax Museum.
Okay, yeah, I'm thinking of something. You're right. Yeah, Wax Museum is great, but goes on a minute. It was fine. It was a little forgettable for me. And maybe that's just because it goes on a minute.
Yeah, well, the big machine, you know, Tom Hanks is big, that kind of thing talking to you.
Yeah.
You know, the machine.
The Zoltar machine.
Yes.
Yes.
Them doing that voice, talking, that part's great.
It's awesome. That's
and
it's an
a great
awesome intro.
Yeah. Yeah. But who, baby? Yeah. Murder go round.
Murder
go round. How you gonna fuck with the wicked clown?
This, yes.
Innocent Posse got the dog beats, ICP. Got the dog beats.
I've listened to the album twice now.
Ooh.
I feel like I'll like Murder Go Round on a third listen.
Oh, whoa.
As it is now, I'm kind of like, it's fine. It's not my favorite song on the album.
We mentioned it many times up front, but... As you can see, this is why I was saying forks up, forks down, forks sideways.
Oh, yes.
So this is gang shit.
Okay.
Like, it's related to that. And especially on this album, they kind of open up and say, like, hey, gangs of Detroit, of New York.
Hey, oh my gosh, what's that?
Leonardo.
Yeah. Hey, Leonardo, sit down on this one. Well, we're not talking to the gangs of New York. We're talking to the gangs of Detroit.
Yes, John C. Reilly of Chicago. I think that's also Gang Shits of Chicago.
Wait, the movie Chicago?
Yeah, isn't that about... Oh, that's not about gangs?
No, it's about the media circus around a woman murdering her husband.
Oh, okay. Oh, is that about... I went on a weird Chicago tour, and I think they were just talking about the rash of... women who murdered and would get off because the jury's like, they wouldn't, they're a woman.
Not
they
her.
Wouldn't do that.
She needs a device to stimulate her clitoris so she doesn't go crazy.
It's baffling that, but also like cool that so many women in hardcore murder trials got off. And the only one that finally didn't is because they straight up murdered someone in the middle of the street during the day.
Hi, bang.
Yeah, and so like there were so many people that'd be like, yeah, they We saw her.
No, that one happened.
You need to convict her.
No. But yeah, that's what Chicago's about.
Okay, okay.
Great musical. Check it out.
Okay, John C. Reilly. I'll do it.
John C. Reilly is so fucking good in that, too.
But yeah, Murder Go Round, I love it. It's a nice story.
He plays a clown in that. Sorry, Murder Go Round.
Oh, really?
Kind of a clown. His song is very clown, very vaudeville.
What was he? Was he a friggin' congressman?
But Murder Go Round, you say.
So...
I detracted
us. There are also, like, the Ringmaster is showing you attractions in the dark carnival. That's kind of, like, so you have Murder Go Round.
This is a good sort of second act in that it's setting up this new world of the... We have crossed into the dark carnival. We have crossed the threshold into the world of the dark carnival.
Yeah.
Now we are being introduced to, well, what is the dark carnival? Mm-hmm.
Like My Fun House, House of Mirrors, and then there was one more, Wagon.
I'm still confused. I guess one of the things about this album is I'm still confused when we're listening to... ICP, and when it's the voice of the Ringmaster.
The Ringmaster, you'll know, is because it's pitched up and he rolls his R's. And then,
okay,
as the intro states, ICP is doing the deeds.
Yes.
Of
and I kind
the
of
Ringmaster.
Love that, where they're like, we're not the Ringmaster. Mm-hmm. We work for the Ring. That makes it so much scarier to me, mm-hmm, is that we're the worst shit you've ever seen. This isn't the worst shit we've ever seen. There is someone more evil and more wicked than us.
Oh, but
they're
not,
named the more wicked, I'll say. Not evil.
I'm not even going to... indifferent.
Okay.
Impartial.
I thought, well, he's the judge, though, isn't he?
I mean, you should be an impartial judge. You should just see it as this or like this or that.
So I'll take evil out of it and we'll just say wicked.
Okay.
Because I think wicked can be impartial but still gratuitously violent.
Okay.
But there is someone even more
like Jason Voorhees.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah, because he's
Freddy Krueger.
But like that to me is very, and it's just scarier. It's just that there's someone
Baby from Demonic Toys.
Here's the baby from Demonic Toys. Oh, I'm terrified of this baby. But there's a bigger baby, the boss baby, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what this album kind of delves with. I hope we learn more about the Ringmaster as these albums come out, because I am invested in this character.
I think we'll learn more when we get to the comics.
Okay.
Oh man. Whoo, baby, I'm excited.
We're all okay, but Murder Go Round. Yeah, I think on a third for me, I think on a third listen, maybe I'll like, because I think it was one of those things like, I like this. I know this isn't making my list, probably.
I love this song. A lot of these songs that I say like are fantastic. And speaking of which.
Yeah.
It's the first time we see that ICP is truly capable of writing a hit song, and that is with Chicken Huntin'.
Yeah. Is that the next song?
Yes.
Okay, Chicken Huntin' was fun.
Who's going chicken huntin'? Who's going chicken huntin'? Cut a motherfucking chicken up, right?
That was a great hook. That was a fun hook. Again, very confused the entire time. Like, I thought I knew what chicken neck meant, but it makes sense now. It makes sense where it comes from.
I forgot... that I was going on a story to tell about forks up, forks down, forks sideways. I once said that around Nicole. And Nicole, last week after we were recording, came home from free comic book day. She works at a comic book store.
Mm-hmm.
And I was discussing like ICP stuff. And she's like, is this going to be my life now? I didn't fucking sign up for this.
Aww.
And I was like, you technically did. Like, our first date, I wore a KYP shirt. You knew that eventually
this would come up.
Yes.
I think that's part of the reason I'm here, is to make sure you get all of your clown shit out, mm-hmm, now, so that when Nicole comes home, she doesn't have to deal with this nonsense.
I would love, okay, listeners out there.
Yeah.
My spouse, Nicole, she's very receptive to all the other shit I enjoy besides ICP in just a broad sweep.
Mm-hmm.
Weird Al's music.
Yeah, she likes Weird Al as a person.
Yes, and as an actor and a voice actor, comedian.
He's funny.
But does not like his music. But I know why. Her, mm-hmm, brother just played the shit out of him.
Fair.
And which... so much of the shit that, like, I think also South Park she doesn't fuck with because her brother played the shit out of it.
Yeah.
Also, like, a lot of trauma stuff she doesn't seem to enjoy. She's very receptive to all the other, like, the Chris Gethard show. That was our first date, was her coming over on a Wednesday night.
I'm watching Chris Gethard show?
Yes.
That's very sweet.
Was our first date.
That's a good first date. That's a good date show. It's very wholesome.
You used to be able to, on their Tumblr, see what the topic was.
Yeah.
And the topic for that episode, oh, it was already planned, was the dizzy episode.
Oh, I haven't
seen
that.
Where they were going to just get dizzy. And I was like, fuck. No, she's going to fucking hate this. She's going to have to come over and we're going to have to watch like the crowdsource character before that.
Okay.
So that's what we did.
Yeah.
But it starts out and they said, hey, we were going to get dizzy and do challenges. That was going to be our show. However, we got a Google alert that someone accessed our Gmail account and that came from North Carolina. Like they were like, this is from Charlottesville.
Yeah.
Where Gimghoul is.
Who's Gimghoul?
A Gimghoul is... I cannot, like, it's too much to unpack.
Okay.
It's a fraternity at, like, Chapel Hill, I think is the college that Murph, he started, like, threatening them and, like, started outing them as being, like, people who, like, sexual assaulted and, like, had ties to the Illuminati and all of that stuff.
Murph was outing Gimghoul?
Yes.
Okay.
This fraternity.
Okay.
I think allegedly, but maybe there is documentation, like most fraternities,
sure,
that they have dark pasts and maybe presents.
Yeah.
And that ended up being the episode. I was like, fuck yes. So it wasn't just them getting dizzy. And then like Nicole immediately was like, I'm fully on board for this batshit crazy show.
Yeah. Fucking
so,
A.
With that in mind, what do you guys think? She loves comics. She writes or draws comics. Should she come on the comic book episode where we're probably also going to be doing? We'll also be talking about the Pendulum. Spoiler alert: the CD.
Yeah.
Should she come on that? Give us what you, as someone who maybe has a spouse that doesn't like ICP, but maybe there is one thing that they're okay with. What would be the episode she should guest on?
Mm-hmm. What do you think is the entry point?
Yes.
And also, to be fair, we're not going to make her do it if she's like, yo, fuck this shit. That's fair. That's totally fair.
I think the entry point in my eyes is Big Money Rustlers.
Which I don't know.
Which is
their movie.
Yes. One of their movies.
Okay.
And it's the cowboy Western one. And I think it's just so fucking dumb that she could find enjoyment in it.
We'll play with it. Okay. We got so much
yes.
to get through.
All right. Next up is, I believe, the first ever ICP song I ever heard at that youth group, which is Mr. Johnson's Head, or it was Dead Pumpkins.
Mr. Johnson's Head is so good.
Yes.
I really liked that song. I thought it was so. There's one line I wrote down. Again, I don't take many notes on the album listening through. I had to write down this line because I had to make sure I got it right. It's the start of the second verse. So the first verse, we don't really like, I just don't like my teacher. Mm-hmm. And then until like the last line is like, by the way, I fucking cut his head off. Like I love, and because I was listening to it, I wasn't listening to the song, the titles. So I'm just hearing the song. I'm just like, okay, cool. And then the chorus hits. I'm like, yeah, this is where this is going. So that was like a nice surprise. And the second verse starts after, again, he's already admitted to murdering his teacher, heads in the bag. Second verse, I wish somebody knew me because they could say I'm wrong.
Uh-huh.
But since nobody knows me, I got it going on. That gives me straight up chills.
Yeah.
That is because at this point, it's still pretty like, it's, you know, it's murder. It's MDK all effing day, murder, death, kill. Shouts out to fucking Nick Gage. But like, it's a lighthearted. There's still a campiness to the murder here. I feel like that. To me, that line, the second that line drops, I'm like, oh, this song's not about murder. It's about being alone.
Yeah.
This song's about feeling removed and feeling unseen. And that fucking line, I wish. Wishing is so vulnerable. The act of like, I want something. I wish for something. And something so simple as, I wish somebody not even liked me, just knew me.
And
fuck.
It is also a sense of, you're kind of okay with the murder because you hear that like he's just a bigot and he has a rebel flag and all of that.
Yes.
So, but yeah, it's very self-aware. It's truly mind-boggling when you're like, oh, they're just stupid ICP. But then you're like, oh no, it is morality. It's not just senseless murder. There are backstories with these things.
Yeah. The lines aren't clever. In some ways, it's a little bit of Stephen King, where Stephen King is not the most, I like Stephen King. He is not a very flowery writer. He's not like, he's not like putting in all this dialogue that blows your mind or all this real witty banter. Mm-hmm. He's just telling a good story.
Yeah.
It's, you know, the language is simplified, but the stories, or the language is simple, not simplified. I don't think he goes out of his way to do it. He just has a naturally simple, blunt language, but the stories are just good. And I feel like that's what I get out of certain ICP songs, especially this one.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love this.
It's very good.
Yeah.
Next up is Southwest Song.
I was confused by this. What is a Southwest song?
So Southwest Detroit is Del Rey. That is where they're from.
Okay.
So that's why you'll hear like Del Rey. Also in last episode, Wizard of the Hood used to be Wizard of Del Rey.
That makes sense. Yeah, because when I'm listening to it, I'm thinking like, is Southwest Song a metaphor for death?
No.
Okay, but I did get that feel where every time there's someone singing their Southwest song, it feels like that person is going on their way to die. Not even like in traditional, like, we're the carnival, we're going to kill the evil people. Like, no, just people die. Everyone sings. And again, maybe it's just me. I've been watching a lot of Lance Archer, who reminds us all, everybody dies. Everyone dies.
Also, real quick, when you said, like, murder, death, kill, who were you shouting out to?
Nick Gage, who is a hardcore wrestler with GCW. If you're into, like, American death matches and, like, hardcore-style matches, and you don't know who Nick Gage is, he's great. He was recently on television. He was the second trial of Chris Jericho.
Does he do any cage matches?
You mean like UFC style?
No, like, you know, like cage matches.
Oh, like a cage match? I'm sure, here's the thing, he's a vet. Okay,
should we do a podcast called Encaged with Nick Gage?
Yes. Is that what you're going with?
Yes, that's all I wanted to go back to that
Absolutely
for.
Absolutely worth it, 100%. Yes.
Nicole and I have a podcast on patreon.com/MLMpod called Engaged with Nicolas Cage.
Worth it.
The first line of this song is always in my head, and it's Facteria smoke and choke and pain because Del Rey funk is in my brain.
Yeah.
It's an industrial area. Also, I think it's near Zug Island, which is just like an island of industry. And in Behind the Paint, I believe, Violent J talks about at nighttime when they would like pour like the molten metals, it would light up the sky.
That's a great line.
And it would glow. So that's why, like, the Facteria smoke, and it's very, like, smog heavy. You'll also hear, I think, on the Terror Wheel, they get into the smog and stuff.
I kind of want to listen to this song again now that I know it's just a love letter to Del Rey.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome. Yeah, the first line, too, is like, yeah, it's great.
Also, then I like that they place this here because Shaggy says, "So get off me, dog." And then the next episode is Get Off Me, Dog.
Yeah.
And I think it's a perfect short solo song.
My favorite part about this song is that it's short.
Oh, you a little scamp. But it sets up ICP lore in establishing that Shaggy 2 Dope has like stretchy long testicles.
Oh, I missed that.
He says, wow, I did not write that down. I just said like, so.
No, but that's cool, yeah.
There's songs like Super Balls. He goes by like Stretch Nuts, The Ball Bounce, which is on Fuck the Fuck Off, which is like a fantastic kind of like Miami meets crunk rap song about like nut sacks and shit. It's cool.
Sure. That's awesome. That's such a, man, I gotta listen to that again too, just cause like I missed that. And that's such a fun, we've all had that schoolyard conversation. If you could have any superpower, what superpower do you want to have? And here's just like, it's the stretchiest nuts you've ever seen.
Yeah.
I walk up to Superman and I stretch him out. I'm like, huh? Huh? Justice League me, daddy. I love it.
Invisibility, of course. That's what I would want. So then I could scare Nicole real good.
Bleh. Because it goes back, and it goes back to like, one of the big things, and I always say this when I sign up on the podcast, I don't know if I'm a fan of their music, but I like so much else around ICP.
Hell yeah,
dude. Stretchy Nuts being one of them.
The next one is Who Asked You, which is another, like, you get two solos right after each other. Oh, but one thing I wanted to comment on Southwest Song, we're starting to hear Shaggy a lot more on this album.
Shaggy, just so I get the voices right, Shaggy's usually, if I'm hearing a different voice in the chorus doing the hook, that's Shaggy, right?
Maybe.
Okay, fair enough.
Get Off Me, Dog is Shaggy 2 Dope.
Okay. Okay, Get Off My Dog wasn't my favorite.
Oh, man.
I know.
He's coming into his own. The scratch work you're hearing is also him.
Okay. I think it might be in Murder Go Round on a quick. There was it sounded like the Evil Laughter scratch work, and I loved that. I think that was Murder Go Round.
Probably.
And just scratching the evil laugh was great. Sorry to backtrack. But yeah, I don't think that makes sense though that he's coming into his own. Because there are moments where I'm like, you could be a little bit more confident.
Yeah.
There.
It's also weird, maybe because people weren't hearing him a lot. Mm-hmm. He is the first one to have a solo, like, this is Shaggy Too Dope.
Yeah.
And it's an EP called Fuck Off, which we'll get to in, I think, 2 or 3 weeks.
Okay. At this point, I'm kind of like, I like Shaggy Too Dope when he comes on hooks and choruses because I think he's got great energy.
Oh, yeah.
Like, at this point, it feels...
When he's screaming, you are the love of my life.
Yeah, he's such a romantic. So, like, that's kind of what I'm like... I don't know. It's part of it. Get Off Me Dog felt like maybe I don't know if we should have Flavor Flav all of these verses.
Oh,
and check D back in here.
I like Get Off Me Dog,
and that's fair.
Who Asked You is fine. Like it's it's for the most the first the chunk of it is quick, and then it just goes on for like it just keeps looping the same thing over and over again.
Yeah.
Then we have the Dead Ones, which
Dead Ones was great.
It has the best production, and it sounds like a neo-gothic western, if that makes sense to anyone.
I get that. I especially get the neo-gothic. I think it's the... I don't know if this is the first song where they're going from the point of view of someone who's not already in the carnival.
Maybe.
Because it doesn't feel like... To me, when I'm listening to it, the narrator, the voice we're hearing, is not a member of the carnival. Maybe they joined the carnival in death. Maybe they become like a zombie warrior or something, a zombie carny.
Riddlebox has those.
But yes. But like at this point, this is the act of them dying and accepting they're dying, and that's fucking rad.
The comic books for sure have zombie
carnies.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. So the dead one in this. I want to know who this dead one is. If it's a specific, he becomes someone in lore, or if this is just sort of an entry point for us, the viewers, to be like, hey, if you're not in the, you're probably not in the carny because you don't start in the carnival. You get your way. You earn your way. I mean, you don't come out of the womb listening to ICP eventually.
Yeah,
I don't know what
when
the
you go into purgatory as a baby, do you have to be baptized in a vat of cotton candy Faygo or?
That's the line. It's like, here's the baptismal water. Here's the cotton candy Faygo. This is St. Peter, by the way. Here's the cotton candy Faygo. Uh-huh. You can choose either line. Please don't choose the cotton candy Faygo. And that cotton candy Faygo line out the fucking door.
They're like, you want to know what? When you submerge my head, enjoyed it. But like just the fizz after, I wasn't too fond of. That's my review of cotton candy Faygo. It's so sweet. Oh, my God. It's too sweet.
Too sweet.
Once it gets on your tongue, it tastes exactly like cotton candy, but has a weird fucking aftertaste.
Yeah. I do want to.
What's up?
I don't want to stop talking about the dead one before.
Oh, yeah,
move on.
Keep going.
Okay, but I also want you to finish your point on Cotton Candy Faygo.
Listeners need
to know how you feel about Cotton Candy Faygo.
Oh, I was just going to say I'm excited. I think for the Love Tunnel of Love, which I forget how it's pronounced, which, oh my God, you see Shaggy Too Dope's dick in that. Oh my God.
Oh no.
For real, I'm not kidding.
Yeah, I know.
It's
that's
on the album cover.
That's
it's
why
great.
I say oh no.
It's fantastic.
Good dick.
We're probably going to do a Faygo review
that
one. That's the one Nicole comes on. I'll drink some soda.
Oh, boy. I feel like the dead one. Yeah, I feel like the dead one is a good departure. And you know, I'm going to go back. I think vulnerability is probably my favorite thing when I'm watching someone, any performer, comedian, musician, actor, whatever. Like vulnerability, that's why we watch. Like the dead one, it's just about a dude not ready to accept that he's dead. And I think it's Violent J who's screaming, am I dead?
Yeah.
Just Violent J not being ready to go. Like that, fuck, I was not expecting that. And it was good. That hit me. I liked the dead one.
Me too. It's one of my favorites. I like the guitar sting they got into it. Mm-hmm. It's fucking great.
Yeah, yeah.
This one specifically is I would have on repeat while playing Spyro 2.
Okay.
Man, I love Spyro 2. Next up is My Fun House.
Yeah.
Which the beginning skit of like, oh yeah, her husband's dead and she's hysterical. Well, did you try fondling her breasts? No, I haven't. Ma'am, how's this? Do you feel better? Yeah.
So fucking dumb.
It's so funny.
So stupid.
It holds up. It's good.
Okay. Who's Chet?
Chet?
I think it's my fun. Yeah, it's my fun house. Oh, hold on. I also have one last note on the dead one. I'm so sorry.
Go for it.
I forgot. I did write down a lyric. My boys stare at me. I wonder what they think. They don't blink. And my teeth keep popping out. I stink. I popped really hard and I stink. It's something about the way he delivers, like, my boys are staring at me. I don't know what's going on. My teeth are falling. And I stink. On top of everything else, also I stink. Oh, boy.
Yeah, that's just ICP's.
It's just great.
Campiness.
It was so fun. And in a song that doesn't have a lot of campiness, just also, but, and I stink. On top of
P.U.
That popped me. But on the Funhouse, at some point, they reference, I think they say Chet, and that is Chet's house.
I don't know.
Weird. If you know, hey, if your name's Chet, let us know. How's your house looking?
Chet Hanks, maybe?
I hope. Oh, boy. We're moving on.
This one's just a very fast-paced story, and it's great.
Funhouse is fine. I didn't love it, actually. I thought it was fine.
For the Maggots, baby.
For the Maggots was interesting. That was a quick one, too.
Yes. I love this song, and this is something I need to tell you.
Okay.
I don't know if you're aware of Slipknot fans are called Maggots.
Okay.
But I believe this is way before that comes about.
See, I was a big Slipknot fan.
Ooh. Shaggy Too Dope. They're too stretched to the floor. You slip on them.
Oh, I was referencing the Conan O'Brien sketch, which featured a lot of gentlemen slipping on nuts that opened one time for a Slipknot, and that's true. I forget. It was some like big New York City concert. And I think it's like H. John Benjamin, Brian McCann maybe, and then like one other Conan writer. All they do is wear bow ties, and they slip on nuts, and then Slipknot comes out.
Hell yeah.
It's fucking ridiculous. It's great. But, sorry, you were talking about Slipknot.
Slipknot,
yes.
So Maggots and Juggalos had a beef with one another, but there was never a Slipknot ICP beef. It was just like a fan base beef for some reason. I've never gotten into it.
It probably started from like two friends listening to either Slipknot or ICP, and then one of them goes into the other camp, and like that's the beef. It's like, oh, my friend I used to listen to these albums with is now into a different band more so. Fuck all of them.
Maybe.
I lost my friend.
What could have, this is my guess. I'm not going to say which one I think would be the annoying one. One of those fan groups also likes the other, goes to the concert, and they're obnoxious as fuck. And it's just a recurring thing like, oh, these people are obnoxious. Fuck them.
Same way Magic the Gathering players feel about Yu-Gi-Oh! Players sometimes.
Okay.
I'll say it, Yu-Gi-Oh! Players. Magic, baby. Please continue.
So there, one of an old MLM pod show, I'll get there, hosted by myself, Courtney, and Monse. Monse lived in Iowa. I asked Monse, hey, would you want to come on and do Iowa, like as like a quick side story?
Yeah.
And she's like, dude, I was in a coma during Iowa, like my lifetime in Iowa. No. I was like, okay, what about if Courtney came on, who's from Michigan and like probably knows Juggalos back in Saginaw? What if Courtney came on and secondhand stories of your time in Iowa, because they're best friends, they live together.
Yeah.
Would you be okay with that? And then Monse just laughs and goes, yeah, I'd like that one. So Courtney's fine with that. That is what we will eventually review a Slipknot's Iowa.
Okay.
For our podcast.
Sounds good. What song are we on right now?
We are now on to Wagon Wagon Dead Bodies Dragon. This is a crying call for weirdos, and it's the first time we hear like Down with the Clown, I believe.
Oh, interesting. I thought this song was too long.
Oh, yeah, probably. Yeah. I mean, a lot of these are way too long.
And I hate that that's my big colored impression of it. It was just like, it painted itself with the brush of like, God, this song could probably lose a little bit. And because I missed that. I missed the first time we'd get Down with the Clown. I miss a lot of the themes in it because I'm just like, eh.
That's why pretty much after generally the second chorus or if there's a third verse after that, just skip.
But except for like the third verse of what was it from the last album? The
Black in Your Eyes, you loved that one.
No, what was the song? I Have Sex with Rednecks. Fuck Rednecks.
Oh, Redneck Ho?
I thought like the thing, Redneck Ho doesn't get really good until like the very end, and you're just like, oh. It's like sometimes it's a good post-credit scene. I don't know.
But with this, you also hear like a 17 reference, which is a recurring theme in ICP.
Okay.
I believe it started because Carnival of Carnage on its first day only sold 17 albums. But I believe they were excited about that.
Yeah.
Like it's like, hey, we
17 people wanted to listen to my music.
Yes,
that's
on
huge.
First day.
That's huge. I'm still stoked when 10 people show up in my chat when I'm twitching.
Oh, man. I'm
Guzman Kaiser, twitch.tv.
I'm excited when one person is continuously
it's
chatting.
The best.
So,
yeah.
That's a recurring theme. 17, you'll hear it later. Also, okay. The butterfly, you'll hear. It ain't about the butterfly or 17. When we speak of Shangri-La, what you think we mean? And then in the concert, I'm crying right now. Also, before this time, I'm crying right now. This is a song that, if you were to listen now, you'd be like, what the fuck is this? But this is my hope. When we get to the song, Thy Unveiling, you either start tearing up or you full on cry.
Okay.
That is my hope.
Okay. I'm not saying anything because I cannot promise that.
Go to Mostly Speaking Sentai on Twitch. There is, you'll know it by the thumbnail. It is Sora from Kingdom Hearts with Juggalo face paint on. Nicole likes doing these things where she reads without ever listening to an ICP song, just reads the lyrics. And I was like, oh, you should read Thy Unveiling. And during this, I have a voice modulator on. It's auto-tuned, it's echoed, and it's low voiced. She starts reading these lyrics, and I am crying from just her reading them.
And she has like no context.
No, she has no context. And also like she's not like singing it like... She's just reading it monotone.
Like not even performing necessarily, just reading.
And I'm crying.
That's amazing. Okay.
Oh man, it's such a good song.
But Wagon.
Eh. This song, like this and a lot of the other production has like a chug feel to it. Like
yeah. Yeah, it's so weird that like last episode, I did not listen to the album as much as I listened to this episode.
It's good.
But there are so many songs, like now you talk about, I'm like, fuck, I kind of have to like Wagon, I kind of want to give another shot to. I want to give another shot to Murder Go Round.
Because I say that. Those are ones you should.
Yeah, because like Wagon just didn't do it for me.
Wagon, dead body's dragon.
Like it was fine. It just wasn't like, it wasn't one of my favorites. It didn't like pop to me.
But next up is The Loons. And this is, I would like to read lyrics from.
Please do.
He says, stab you in the back of the head, why not? Your little governor is taking everything I got. I can't feed a family, I can't feed a dog, so I cut your fucking head off. Hey? the hey, of course.
Yeah, I like that.
How I said it ruins the messaging. But when I'm so glad you brought this, that murderer from that you discussed last time.
Oh, Leslie.
Vernon. Behind the mask.
Sorry. The murderer, Leslie Williams.
I think it has to be a reference to this song.
I think so too.
Or this song is a reference to that.
Because, that felt. Yeah, the loons felt a lot like we're. There are actual evil people out there. Like, hey, we're doing it for camp, but we're acknowledging that there are Leslie Williamses and like straight up murder.
And
murderers.
This person does, as it's a morality tale, they're killing innocent people. Mm-hmm. They die in the end.
Is this. Wait, hold on. I want to make sure I don't get it wrong. Because is this the neck?
Yeah, I'm the neck cutter and I'm three blocks away.
Yes, that's a great hook.
It is.
That's such a great hook.
It's a classic.
It's so good. Also, the end. Do you mind if I jump to the end of the song?
Yeah, go for it.
Because one of my favorite things is just he's outside the hall. He's like, I'm outside you. I'm then. And this isn't the chorus anymore. Like the final chorus hit, and now he's just kind of muttering to himself, neck cutter, that's me. I'm Mr. Neck Cutter. And then you just kind of hear a shotgun and some fucking dude, I got his ass. I fucking got him.
He ain't coming around here anymore.
That was so fucking funny to me.
Hell yeah.
It's just so funny to me. And it's terrifying. Like he is like, especially if he's based on real life Leslie Williams.
Leslie Vernon.
Williams.
Have you ever seen Behind the Mask, the story of Leslie Vernon?
I don't know who Leslie Vernon is.
It's a it's a faux documentary, a mockumentary, if you will, that dissects slashers. It's someone going around. It's in a world where slashers exist.
Okay.
And a film crew for their like college thesis is doing a documentary about this person who's trying to become a slasher.
The next Michael Myers.
Yes.
Or Jason Voorhees, who in this world are not characters. They are real people.
Yes. And it is truly one of the best horror movies ever because it's funny. The acting is great. It's just great.
Behind the Mask?
Yes. Behind the Mask, the story of Leslie Vernon. It's on Amazon Prime just for, if you have Amazon Prime.
Shout out to Behind the Mask. I'm the neck cutter and I'm as soon as they open this
door. I'm the neck cutter and I'm two blocks away.
The hook is great. I'm not downplaying how much I truly enjoyed the hook. But my favorite is still just him muttering on the front porch, just as soon as you bum the neck.
It's like Beavis and Butthead type.
It
like
kind of is, yeah.
If Beavis and Butthead walked up and they're like,
and we're also murderers. Yes. If Beavis and Butthead were serial killers.
Butthead.
I couldn't get it out because it's so funny. It's so good.
Okay, let's keep going. We have just a couple more. This one, I just have.
I need to actually get the whole off. Okay, I'm ready.
Okay, Love Song, it's perfected later, but this was included on the mix CD that I lost my virginity to.
Yeah, I see that.
So we can just skip that
it's
one,
fine.
Right?
Yeah, it's fine. I do, you know what? No, I do want to appreciate they're no longer just enjoying the fetishization of fat women. They also just ugly bitches they're into now. And I think that's progress. In quotes, yes.
Because
they do specifically say, fuck ugly bitches now.
One of my favorite things is going on Pornhub, and if you just search ugly, it's just like, they're never ugly. It's just everyday women. Mm-hmm. So just search ugly woman, and chances are you'll be like, oh, hell yeah, this is someone who, like, I went to work with.
They do have fun defining what ugly is to them in the next song. Which I'm ready to talk about.
Splinow now.
Wait, what are you saying? Were you making fun of me mumbling?
No. Okay. They're fucking women who look like splinow now.
What? I don't remember this. Is this in this song?
Yes,
do I not remember
hold
this?
On.
Okay. No, don't.
I can bring it up.
Okay.
Splinow now.
I do. So if you're wondering, what the fuck are we talking about? The song is Bugs on My Nuts. Bugs on My Nuts.
Or Bugs on My Nugs in printings.
Okay, but or Bugs on My Nugs. Dude, I like this song way more than I probably should
have.
It's so funny. This song popped me so hard. He defines one avenue, a possible ugly bitch, is the one-titted crack whores they like to fuck.
Okay. Yes.
Fuck, I can talk. I just want to talk about this song.
Okay.
So
okay.
Good. No, but play it. Yeah, play it. What the fuck does that mean? This song is so funny. It's just, and oh my gosh, fuck! I should have wrote it down. Can you talk about it for a second while I look for a lyric?
This is my note.
Okay,
it's a good song. I skip,
okay.
And it's not for me, but it is catchy.
It also goes splanana. It's catchy. I think it gets into a lot of like juvenile 90s humor, which is just so fucking funny.
Truly, the chorus is a chorus of crabs singing to you.
Okay, so one point. So here's a great line from this one. So let's talk about, because the chorus is crabs. The verses are Violent J and Shaggy 2 Dope being very open about their crabs. So let's talk about my nutsack. I don't front Jack. I got bugs on my nutsack. It's so fucking, this is what I was looking for. I'm always quick to tell you when my nuts itch. Cause bitch, if I'm itching when I come, just the idea of like, hey, if my nuts itch, I'll tell you. And I'm telling you right now, my nuts itch. Like, it's just something about being very open about, which is also great. Like, be open with your partners, obviously, if you, with whatever. But just something about like, just taking pride, because it's not just like being open. Because it's that rap like pride. Like, I don't front. I ain't bullshitting. I'm telling you right now, my nuts itch.
I got bugs on my balls at.
Like, this song's fucking great. This song's fucking great.
Damn, I was not expecting you to say that.
I wasn't either.
Hell yeah.
I was not either.
All right, man, we have our last song.
Yeah.
House of Mirrors, again, capital E is back to close it out. And I think this is a fucking great song.
It's fine. Yeah, it's real good. What is Ringmaster's World? Because I have Ringmaster's World on
mine. Oh, Ringmaster's Word? That's it's there.
Yeah.
Because all it is just like, this is what I think it was. They paid for the beat, and then they couldn't, they were like, well, we don't have anything to write to this. Let's just loop up, like, two different four-bar loops over and over again.
Okay, then yeah, and then House of Mirrors, it's great, and it makes sense, but man, I don't think, for me and my 9-year-old sense of humor, you can't fucking follow Bugs on my nuts. It's impossible.
Okay.
He doesn't front, Jack. He's got balls on his nutsack. Okay. Bugs on his nutsack.
Then we have to just go, like, I'm afraid now.
Yeah, I know. Me too.
What is your song?
Okay, cool. And we'll do it like how we did last time. Like a couple of options. Because let's see. Because we're making this list together.
Okay.
Because I want to know what you're choosing. So what are my big ones? Fuck. Mr. Johnson's Head is definitely on my list.
All right.
I know. I think the Dead One was great. That For the Maggots is a great. Fuck, man. Bugs on My Nuts is my number two, though. Or my one or two. I don't know between them.
Wow. We have zero overlap.
We have zero overlap?
Mine
shit.
Is Southwest Song, Wagon Wagon, House of Mirror. So I think...
Okay.
I think I pick my favorite out of yours, and you pick your favorite out of mine.
I disagree.
Oh, okay.
Because I feel like you're going to choose Mr. Johnson's Head. And I gotta choose Bugs on My Nuts.
Okay, fine.
Then
both of us will choose out of my three.
Okay. I want to say why Bugs on My Nuts over Mr. Johnson's Head. I think Mr. Johnson's Head is the better song.
Yeah.
But I think as an introductory for like, what are you getting into with ICP?
Yeah, you need to show like, hey, you might get some of this.
This is the humor. This is kind of like, because it's so important. I forget what it was. It was Besties, which is a great podcast about video games. And one of the reviews was like, I learned as a video game reviewer, meet the game on its level. Don't expect the game to be something it's not.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that with all media.
Yeah. That's what Doughboys talk about with fast food.
Absolutely.
They're rating not as a perfect restaurant. It's, are they doing what they go out to do?
Yes.
And I think that's what all reviews should be based on.
Yes. Agreed. And I think when it comes to Bugs on My Nuts, that is so indicative. From what I remember from like seeing them on Mad TV and like this sense of humor, this juvenility is something if you're like, you should meet them on that level.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to get into ICP, you need to meet them on the, I ain't gonna front. I got Bugs on My Nuts. If you're okay with that humor, that you're going to be in for a good time. I encourage you to go listen to Mr. Johnson's Head because that song's great and it's so fucking good. I feel so shitty taking it, like not choosing it. I do. But like, yeah, it's gotta be Bugs on My Nuts.
All right. Then I feel like Wagon Wagon.
Okay.
Because Murder Go Round is more like hectic and it like is setting you up for this chaos.
Yeah.
But Wagon Wagon is a song now. Anyone saying like, well, what about Chicken Huntin'?
Great tune.
Next or in 2 weeks when we get to Riddlebox, it will be chosen.
Okay.
Because
it comes back.
It gets remixed and it's perfected there.
Okay.
And it is so fucking good. I'm glad you weren't like, oh, well, Chicken Huntin', absolutely. And I would have had to veto and said like, no.
Wait for it.
Wait for
it.
Give
it a second.
It is so good on Riddlebox.
Okay.
So, wait, Wagon, so Wagon Wagon.
So Wagon Wagon, Murder Around. What was the third one you had? You had a third one.
Oh, I also had a Southwest Song.
Which is great. But see, that's the thing. Because I would vote Murder Around, but this is your pick, and I don't know Wagon Wagon.
Oh, no.
If Wagon Wagon hits you the way you say
it's Wagon Wagon, Dead Bodies Dragon, it's your last chance.
It's good shit. And it sets up. I like the two from ours because it's a very silly song and a very murder song.
Yeah.
And a very murder together, eat the rich kind of like song. So, like, okay. So
also, yeah. And Wagon Wagon is like picking up like, I believe, shitty people and like going like and killing them. Or it could be picking up good people and bringing them to the dark carnival.
Maybe it's a combination of both.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing with the dead one that I'm interested in the lore. Do they pick up and murder good people and then convert them to the carnival?
I don't know.
Maybe that's some of the conversion. We'll see.
Colonialism, baby.
Bugs on my nuts, baby.
I can't believe that.
Believe it either. I was not. It's so fucking stupid, though.
Oh, man.
It's so good.
I feel like...
Bugs on my nuts is fucking funny.
Or should it be... No. Wagon, that's it.
Do it.
All right. You've locked it in. Now, I would like to close it out with reviews of the album, and we're going to get through this real quick, guys.
Great, because I'm holding in a pee-pee.
All right, so we have someone named Brandon Boom, maybe, said, this is the album ICP became ICP. Yeah. This album is an absolute classic. It improves everything from Carnival of Karnak and expands in ways that would later repeat on their albums. It's anti-racist, anti-violence against women. Their message is to be good people. I like that. It truly, that's my sentiment. It improves on Carnival of Carnage, and this is where they become ICP.
Yeah. Maybe skip Love Song if you're interested in maybe they were more clearer about their anti-violence towards women. At one point, there's a line where I'm like, I hit women a lot, but that's okay. I'm violent.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh. I get what you're going with.
Yeah, that part I was like skeptical on because were other. Also, I think like Bugs on My Nuts. There is also.
I think they're trying to be the we're still shitty dudes. Like. We're playing this character to satirize this sentiment.
Yeah.
But like, yeah, I don't know. Bugs on My Nuts does it better than Love Song. Fuck Love Song. Just go to Bugs on My Nuts.
So then there
Perfect
is
tune.
There is one other person who gave this 3 stars saying, not bad. They're ICP and making a full album of good quality tracks goes against their nature. The first few tracks are very good.
That's me.
The rhyming still sucks, but producer Mikey Clark, who is now the full producer.
I love Mikey Clark. I said this last episode. I'm into Mikey Clark.
He knocks it out of the park.
I'm into Mikey Clark with ICP. They have a sound together.
Yeah.
It's very clear they have an aesthetic. They have a shared aesthetic and it fucking works.
And then I want to read the last paragraph. When Get Off Me Dog hits, the album starts to go downhill a little, and as spooky as it is, The Dead One doesn't bring much to the table. It has its ups and downs from there. Take a guess as to where Bugs on My Nugs lands.
Bugs on My Nugs. Bugs on My Nugs.
Overall, this is a surprisingly solid effort, early effort from the world's most hated band.
Yeah. Fuck, I really feel like I should put Mr. Johnson's head as an addendum.
No, we already did it.
But no, we can't.
We can't.
It's Bugs on My Nuts.
Hey, maybe once we get to Forgotten Freshness, it's on there.
Oh, I hope so. I fucking hope so.
We can, but I might make an asterisk on compilation ones.
Yeah.
Forgotten Freshness is like putting, but I think it's a re-recording.
Okay.
So it might be eligible.
We'll see. We'll see when we get there.
There is also one quick thing. This was split up into like 2 sections. Mm-hmm. So like on a cassette and a vinyl, each side, like one is Heckles and one is Macabre.
Interesting.
It's Heckles to pester and annoy, to badger persistently, to ask questions, to ridicule or taunt. And then the Macabre is the dance of dance of death to dwell on the gruesome, suggestive of the horror of death.
Yes.
And that's how those two parts are split up.
Which is great for our picks. You have the Macabre, I have the Heckles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Thank you so much for listening. Let us know what you're liking. Don't let us know what you're hating unless it's in a 5-star iTunes review.
Yeah. Shit on us in 5 stars, baby.
Also, I believe at Marshland Media on Twitter and on MLM Pod on Instagram, if you want to get a hold of us, or just search Marshland Monster, you'll find me on. That's 3 words. But Sean, what you got to plug?
You know me, baby. Twitch.com/ Goose Von Kaiser. Watch me play my bullshit. And Instagram, Sean Marciniak. Twitter, Sean Marciniak. I don't know, man. Send me your favorite wrestling signs because I love that shit.
Hell yeah. Hey, guys, go to MLMpod.com to listen to my rap music, to download that. Most of it's for free over there. You can also find it on under Marshland Monster, wherever music is found. Also have beats there. Also listen to Mostly Speaking Sentai, This Movie's Gay, Hit It and Crit It. Those are wherever you're listening to this. you can search that there, or just go to mlmpod.com for direct links. Then go to patreon.com/mlmpod, which I think what we should do when we get to the movies, we'll do watch-alongs, like your first watch-along of that. It's we watch that, then we go right into the podcast.
Okay.
And that's where those will be, but we'll inform you of that later on.
Alright.
So patreon.com/mlmpod, you get exclusive Patreon podcasts such as Engage with Nicolas Cage,
Boom.
Talking about Beyblade,
Boom.
This Existed,
Boom.
And the Toku Reading Corner.
Boom.
But that's $5 a month. But if you're a $10, you get additional watch-alongs.
Yeah.
It's cool streams sometimes. But you also get shout-outs on all of the free feed podcasts, including this one.
Let's hear them, baby.
So we got Steve F., a.k.a. Hit People Guy. Mm. Eric Berry of Ranger Command Power Hour. Mm. Alex Z., The Waz. Orion, he's a rapper. Defo, D-F-O. Kayla, a.k.a. Two Grapes. Tyler Wright, he's my friend. Elliot W., at Garlic Sunshine. They make fantastic artwork. They once did a fan art of Franklin after Franklin passed away, aww, of Franklin screaming into that C214 over there, that microphone.
Aww.
And then Jordan B., the Chaos Witch.
Hey.
Thank you guys so much. I've been James.
I'm Sean.
And we'll talk to you later, motherfuckers.
Bye.
Bye. This has been a Marshland Media production, produced by James McCollum. For more content, please visit mlmpod.com. To support our network and have access to exclusive podcasts, head over to patreon.com/mlmpod and sign up today.
Oh, yeah.